Exactly. Think it's cool. Sure. Hello, shall we start?
Yes, sir.
So after we are meeting after a long time, and in this term we have last topics covered was glaucoma by Dr. Shadakshari sir. So today I will start a very important topic and its diseases in further lectures. So that is diseases of the lens. It is called as a crystalline lens. So under which we have seen it in detail in the past, in previous or MBBS years, but anatomy, metabolism of lens, and what are the types of cataract and how to classify the cataracts, definition and classification, that we will try to see today. As you know, this crystalline lens is the one of the important in the body, which is transparent and avascular. You are asked one question in sometimes finals in MBBS, which are the avascular structures in the body. So one structure is in the eye, that is lens. Another is cornea, and some I don't remember, but probably something in the knee. There is a avascular structure. So that crystalline lens is a transparent lens because it has to pass the rays from object. Coming from the object, pass through it because it is transparent, and they get either converged on the sensitive layer of retina or main point, that is called the fovea. It is a shape is biconvex, anteriorly convex, posteriorly convex. The convexity differs, but radius of curvature differs, but it is biconvex and crystalline in structure. It is placed between the iris and vitreous in patellar fossa. This patellar fossa is a slight depression because behind the lens is a vitreous, and behind the lens that vitreous front face is called as a hyoid membrane or hyoid face. In that hyoid face, in the center, there is a depression, just like you get dimple on your cheeks. So that in dimple or that patellar fossa, posterior pole or posterior part of the lens fits. Importance of this we will repeatedly tell you in the future, that this patellar fossa location of the posterior pole of the lens, if it is disturbed, then you know that this lens is not in position, and the terminology to that condition is called as a subluxation or dislocation. It is 9 to 10 millimeter in diameter. So equator to equator, from 6 o'clock to 12 o'clock or 3 o'clock to 9 o'clock, it is 9 to 10 millimeter in diameter. Then it has got a thickness which is 3.3 millimeter at birth, because when at birth few fibers are there, nucleus is there, but it is like an embryonic nucleus, very small, and so thickness will be very small. As the age advances, we'll see in future slides, at the age advances, fibers elongate, they go to the periphery, which is mostly metabolically active part in the lens, and they lose their nuclei and they are pushed inside, and again the new ones are laid outside. So like that, the lens fibers, newly laid lens fibers, they go on accumulating in the periphery called as a cortex. So the lens, which was thick 3.3 millimeter in at birth, it becomes almost less than lysity, but double, about 5 millimeter in the old age. Its weight in the air, it is 255 milligram at the age of 40 to 80 years. Then its anterior surface is less convex than the posterior surface. Anterior surface has got radius of 10 millimeter, and posterior surface has got radius of 6 millimeter. So this 6 millimeter means it is a flat, so more flat, and this is more cut. So these differences in the anterior and posterior surface, they help in the formation of correct image on the retina. This lens, like I said, it is placed on the patellar fossa. That is just a location, but how it is hanged, because it is in the center, to remain it in the center on patellar fossa, it has to have attachments. So it is attached to ciliary body or pars plana, that is part of the ciliary body, and with the help of very thin fibers, less than you can say dimensions of the hair, they are called the suspensory ligaments of lens or zonule of chin. So remember, lens is placed or hanged from pars plana of the ciliary body to the periphery of the lens by the structure called the suspensory ligaments of lens or zonules of chin. So posteriorly, these are the circular adhesions with that vitreous, and it is called as a hyaludo. Hyaludo means vitreous, capsular ligament of vigor. So this attachment also is another thing which strengthens the lens remaining in position. Just like that patellar fossa, there is a space. Now when that adhesions are there, hyaludo, capsular ligament of vigor, that adhesion is there, then that adhesion creates a small space between anterior hyaloid face, that is vitreous, and posterior lens capsule. You can imagine how much small that area will be. That is called a Burger space. Burger space. So these spaces may be space. Just imagine in front of eye the space between iris and the lens, and this Burger space is between posterior lens capsule, that is posterior lens, and the anterior hyaloid face. Surgeons nowadays are putting even a very thin, ultra thin lens in this position, not this Burger face, but between iris and the lens, in certain situations where refractory error like myopia or hypermetropia is not able to get corrected by LASIK or some corneal procedure, other corneal procedure. So when cornea is weak, thin, or contraindicated to get operated by LASIK or SMILE or LEX, then they take use of this space, that is a space between iris lens, which is very small. Refractive index. This is one of the, these are one of the figures, a few figures, which at the end of this term you have to collectively remember in the optical media: cornea, aqueous humor, then lens, vitreous. So today we are seeing lens. So refractive index of today's structure, that is lens, is 1.39. As you will go in further slides, this lens has got the central compact portion, very hard as compared to the periphery cortex, that is called as a nucleus, and periphery is called as a soft fibers are there, less compactly arranged, and then capsule is there. So that is called as a cortex. So total refractive index is 1.39, but in that nucleus is got 1.41, and outside is called as a cortex, is got 1.30. As even we are taught, every thing has got a reason why 1.41 in nucleus and why 1.38 in cortex. The rays which are coming from object are parallel. First, they hit air cornea interface, cornea. Then from cornea, slight bending towards close to each other, slightly. Then aqueous is like a fluid, so no much bending. And second bend occurs because of this refractive index of the separate nucleus higher and cortex less. So cornea and lens together bends those rays in such a manner that the object is focused on the fovea centralis. So to bend the rays into the point, the center of the lens, that is called the nucleus, should have higher refractive index than the periphery. That is the reason why whole lens has got 1.39, but cortex is 1.38 and 1.41 is a nucleus refractive index. Then another very interesting answer is there. The power of the eye. When any like muscle, everywhere you say power, power, power like that. So there is a dioptric power to the eye. it is around 60 diopter. Total dioptric power of the eye is around 60 diopter. So this 60 diopter, unless you read or know or somebody talks or tells you, you cannot realize the cornea is the powerful refractive surface. Probably we have covered in the last term of where corneal ulcer, everything was removed before that. So though lens is important structure, its power contributing to the 60 diopter is only 15, 16, 18, 19, not more than that. So dioptric power is there, but it is less as compared to the cornea. So when you are asked about the dioptric power of eyeball, it is 60 diopter total, out of which cornea contributes to 45 and 15, 16, at the most 18, 19 up to is the power of the lens. Then you know, you see long, that is when you are relaxed, there is no accommodation, and you are supposed to look at the infinity. So rays are coming parallel. But when you want to, where somebody gives you a chit number or some writings, then you read, and suddenly from that infinity position, you come to the near distance, 30 centimeter distance. This power which is given to us is called the accommodation. And this accommodative power in children is the strongest, and the age advances. After 40 years, it lessens. You must be looking, okay, all your teachers which have crossed 40 years of age, they are wearing spectacle. Otherwise, they are not able to read what I am reading now, these PPT letters. So this is called as a presbyopia. So our accommodative power is very less. But at the birth, it is 14 to 16, then slightly reduces to half almost, 7 to 8 at 25 years, like for you. And for us, it is 1 to 2 diopter. So we have to aid by the use of glasses. That is called as a presbyopic glasses. Now lens has got very important structures. Again, these are very, this anatomy cannot be taught to you in this lecture, like anatomy of, like a Gray's anatomy and anatomy of lens in that, or in first year. So important structures which are repeatedly helpful to you in the future when we teach you cataract. So mainly there is a lens capsule, which has got epithelium, anterior capsule, posterior capsule doesn't have epithelium. Then there is a cortex which we just touched, periphery, where new lens fibers are laid down and compactly arranged, older one getting inside is the nucleus. So lens is made up of first, that is lens capsule, which is thin. Again, it is transparent, it should be, because the whole lens is also transparent, and hyaline membrane which surrounds the lens. And where it meets in the periphery is called the equator. In that also, micron wise, the lens anterior capsule is thicker than the posterior. I remember when I passed MS, that time the surgery for cataract was full removal of the lens, called the intracapsular cataract. So that time this anatomy was used by us. The thicker anterior capsule we used to catch by one forceps. The name was of that forceps was Aruha. And we used to pull actually the lens out of eye. That method was called the intracapsular cataract. So there our teachers taught ki where to catch with that Aruga's anterior capsule of the lens. Even it is not uniform from top to superior to inferior. That thickness also varies in anterior capsule, but overall posterior is thin, anterior is thick. So next point is that thickest at the anterior pre-equator. So this was the position where our teachers used to keep our fingers with Aruga's forceps in hand to catch the anterior capsule and pull the lens for the successful cataract surgery. And it is thin at the posterior capsule. Then lens epithelium is there, which is present in the anterior capsule, beneath anterior capsule, but it is not present in the posterior capsule. So that is a subcapsular epithelium, cuboidal epithelium, and then when new lens fibers are formed, it becomes columnar, and then it loses the nuclei. And actually lens fibers are formed, which are very early formed, or you can say mature lens fibers. Equator cells. Just now I said equator means anterior capsule and posterior capsule meets periphery. That is called the equator. So these fibers which are laid by the subcapsular epithelium, these epithelium elongates, becomes columnar. then loses its organelles or nucleus mainly, and then is called as a fibers. So these are the equator cells which are actively dividing and elongating to form new lens fibers. So that is the process of making new lens fibers in the human. But there is no subcapsular epithelium in the posterior capsule. So that is an anatomical difference, and probably because of which it is very thin. The lens fibers, which just I said that new lens fibers, so they go on leading to one on another as the age matures or age grows. So old fibers will be pushed inside and new fibers will be laid outside. Mature fibers, just now I said, they lose organelles or nuclei. Most of them are horizontal and they are front to back arranged like a onion layers. So you can just like me feel, because there is one instrument in our OPD, every ophthalmic department, that is called the slit lamp or biomicroscope. This slit lamp or biomicroscope can show this structure like arrangement in onion layers. So you can see as if one layer is separate from the other because of the magnification and you can say microscopic effect of that slit. Make these inner fibers, which are like a older one, they become compact in the center, and that is called as a nucleus. And peripherally, they are not like in compact manner, slightly you can say dispersed or some space is there, that is called as a peripheral cortex. So nucleus is made up of oldest fibers and consists of different zones like embryonic nucleus, fetal nucleus, infantile nucleus, and adult nucleus. So even nucleus, at what age it forms? So from 3 months to birth like 2 to 3 years, then infantile, and after in adulthood, then nucleus forms. That structure is called the adult nucleus. So oldest or earliest one to form is an embryonic nucleus, then fetal nucleus, then infantile nucleus, and then adult nucleus. Again, why it is important? Very simple. If something goes wrong to a mother or a lady who is pregnant, that mother will have some disease like rubella, and that time say embryonic nucleus in the baby is getting formed. So if the mother is suffering from rubella and embryonic nucleus is getting formed, there will be a disease in this embryonic nucleus in the form of cataract, opacification. Then that rubella may get cured or controlled. She will be not suffering from any disease. And then again, fetal nucleus will form, infantile nucleus will form, adult nucleus will form as the after birth and as the that sibling grows. So, but in that baby or in that boy, permanently embryonic nucleus will have some problem. Whiteness, cataract. So whatever abnormal thing is happening in the mother has caused damage to that developing lens, and in the form of the structure which is getting developed, that is embryonic nucleus. So congenital cataracts, they affect these particular zones when some cataractogenic factor is getting affected. The example which I give, rubella to mother, in baby embryonic nucleus was getting formed and it is getting affected. Like that, many conditions can happen. So even infantile nucleus can get affected only, but not fetal, embryonic, and adult. Sometimes only adult nucleus can get affected, but not others. So that is the very interesting thing about the types of congenital cataract. Cortex is peripheral, which comprises of the youngest lens fibers. So metabolically active is a cortex. One which we touched, that is zonule of gene or suspensory ligament of lens, is a complex structure. It is called zonule of gene or sinelli zonule. This gene word also comes in squint topic. There is annulus of gene. So do not get confused. Annulus of gene and zonule of gene. Zonule of gene is suspensory ligament, and zonule of gene is annulus of gene. Hello. Zonulobgene is suspensory ligament of lens, and annulus of Zinn is different. It is tendinous ring in of muscle from which the muscles take origin, like superrectus, inferrectus. So that just I give you idea ki the word is same Zinn, but annulus of Zinn is different, related with squint or muscles, and zonulobgene is suspensory ligament of lens. So complex fibers, and there are series of fibers passing from first plane of the ciliary body to the lens, and they hold the lens in position. And when the lens is not pulled by this in position, because of weak zonules or torn zonules, maybe trauma or some congenital condition like Marfan syndrome, homocystinuria, Wilmer-Chesney syndrome, then these zonules are very weak, and lens is not pulled in position. And then just now I said it is called as a subluxation of lens or dislocation of lens, and then patient will have problem in the clarity of vision or dimness of vision. Lens also, because of the suspensory ligament of lens or zonulobgene, is able to act on ciliary muscle and to give you a function of accommodation. When you are looking straight, the ciliary muscle is relaxed. When you contract ciliary muscle ring diameter reduces and lens swells. So in distant position, lens is flat, and in accommodative position, the lens is slightly swollen. So this is called as accommodation, and this is the very good function God has given to us. As you will know in later, when we remove this lens, in that cataract lens, this is lens, that time this accommodation part is lost. So for many years, we are just removing the lens and putting artificial lens where no accommodation was there. So patient has to wear plus 3 diopter glasses for reading purpose. But now few scientists, ophthalmic scientists, have invented one that is called a multifocal, and one real, not real, but close to natural accommodative intraocular lens. So if that is placed, some amount of near vision can be improved by same lens which is there behind the iris, that is intraocular lens, type of which is called as accommodative lens. Zonular fibers which are making lens suspended in proper position, they are complexly arranged. Some books describe this zonular complex is divided into 5-6 portions. Pars orbicularis, related with pars plana, pars plicata, zonular plexuses. Then fork is there, and to that fork, 3 limbs are there: anterior towards the iris, equatorial at the equator of the lens, and posterior. So there are 5 complex arrangement of fibers called as a pars orbicularis, zonular plexuses, zonular fork, anterior zonular limb, equatorial zonular limb, and posterior. This is not important for you, but remember that the arrangement is also such that the lens is firmly placed behind iris, behind the pupil, on the patellar fossa, and even where you are driving, jumping, exercising, moving, or some impact is there, injury is there, most of the times these zonules get torn, but lens doesn't subluxate easily. So that is the idea of this complex arrangement of the zonular fibers. Then applied physiology and biochemistry in short. Initially, we said that lens is biconvex, avascular, transparent, and crystalline. So transparency is one of the important function or physiology of the lens. And how it is maintained, just like cornea, why or how cornea is maintained transparent should be known to you. Then there are metabolic activities of the lens, because vessels are not there. Sorry for the spelling mistake, it is L-E-N-S, lens. Metabolic activities of the lens. So because these vessels are not there, how the lens gets nourished? So it is mainly from the aqueous and some small amount from the vitreous and accommodation. So these are the important structures related with the lens in physiology and biochemistry: maintenance of transparency, metabolic activities, and accommodation. How the lens transparency is maintained? if our lens is vascular. It is not vascular, but if it is vascular, any structure which is vascular, it will not be transparent. It will be slightly opaque or maybe more dense opaque. So first factor which maintains transparency or keeps the lens transparent is a vascularity. In that, I can mention one condition. You know already, there is a hyaloid system of vessels. So this hyaloid system of vessels supplies the blood, or there is a blood supply to the lens when you are in the womb of mother. So just before birth, it closes. So this hyaloid system, if it persists as an abnormality, then there can be a problem in the lens transparency and there is formation of cataract. The name of that cataract is Mittendorf's dot. So that is the applied importance of this vascularity. If it is vascular, like before birth, and remnant of that hyaloid system, that is called the anterior remnant of hyaloid system, can produce a small spot, white spot on the posterior wall of the lens. Then another, posteriorly there is no epithelium, but anteriorly also there is single subcapsular epithelium which is cuboid. That is another factor which maintains transparency. Then permeability. It is not like anything can go inside, anything can come out. It is highly selectively semi-permeable lens capsule. So it doesn't allow any material to go inside or diffuse outside. So that also maintains transparency. Then characteristically, lens fibers are tightly packed lenses. They have narrow lens fiber membranes and no organelles or no nucleus is there. Then there is a role of proteins, lens proteins, and major intrinsic protein is aquapor, zero. So these proteins are also helpful in maintaining the transparency. These proteins control water transport and glycerol transport. Aquaporin O or MTP mutations are postulated to result in cataract. So many researchers have found why these already form clear lens fibers become opaque. And in congenital cataract, the fibers which are formed, they form in the opaque manner only. So they don't form transparent and then become opaque. They are formed opaque in congenital, and in acquired, they are formed clear and then become opaque. So for that, this new reason has come out. The aquaporin O or MIP mutations are postulated to result in cataract. Even some antioxidant mechanism is there. Then in cornea also there is active pump, passive pump. Especially that active pump is in the endothelium of the cornea. Like that, there is pump mechanism in the lens also. So lens fiber membranes regulate electrolyte which to go inside and drive outside, and water balance in the lens. And idea of it last is a, this structure should be maintained in relatively dehydrated state. There should be water, but relatively less. So it is similar to cornea, but some factors are different than the cornea. So in both, you have to answer why cornea is transparent or how cornea is kept transparent for cornea. And here, this is the points under which you have to explain why lens is, how lens is kept transparent. Auto-oxidation and high concentration of reduced glutathione in lens maintains the lens proteins in reduced state and ensures integrity of the cell membrane pump. So anything which disturbs this auto-oxidation or reduced glutathione level or reduced lens protein state, so proteins increase, then there will be loss of transparency because of the pump failure, and then water will be more imbibed into the lens and cataract will form. in metabolism, the energy in the form of ATP is required to the lens in a continuous manner for various purposes, that is active transport of ions, amino acids, maintenance of that relative lens dehydration, and continuous protein and GSS synthesis. In this, major energy, because active portion is anterior, is utilized in epithelium and some in cortex, but nucleus is inert, inactive. Only 10 to 20% used in protein synthesis. How the lens is supplied? So as it is avascular, that is the question. So it depends for its metabolism on chemical changes in the aqueous humor. Aqueous humor is a clear fluid present between cornea and iris. Some small amount is also there in the posterior chamber, that is between iris and lens. And behind the lens, another fluid is there, which is not fluid, actually gel, or is a vitreous. So this aqueous humor, chemical changes, supply nutrient to the vascular lens. So some small knowledge or little knowledge should be there for chemical composition of lens, chemical composition of the aqueous humor. There occurs active transport across the lens, diffusion across the lens, and synthesis in exchange of chemicals between the lens and the aqueous humor. This is a figure, same figure which is there in corona, and these notes are also from corona. So this depicts or this gives you idea how this active transport, that is pump, occurs, how diffusion occurs, that is leak occurs, or how synthesis occurs, and that is the interaction or action between the chemical composition of the aqueous humor and lens. Mainly glucose metabolism, which is very important for the normal working of the lens. Because if work this lens works normally, you have accommodation, maintaining transparency, you get clear vision. So these things are dependent on the mainly glucose metabolism. Nucleus inactive or inert, but capsule cortex are maintaining or helping this in glucose metabolism. Glucose is mainly coming from the aqueous humor, which gets diffused into the lens and gets metabolized, as you know, through 3-4 pathways. Mainly 3, 4 is only important in diabetes. So first is glycolytic pathway, that is almost 50% metabolism of glucose. Then hexose monophosphate shunt, HMP shunt, 15%, and rest 2 including, but mainly Krebs cycle is 5%. Sorbitol pathway is not important basically as a glucose metabolism in lens, but it is important when that soft cataract, diabetic cataract, or as a snowflake cataract occurs, and it is because of the problem in the sorbitol pathway or accumulation of the sorbitol in the cortex of the lens in diabetics. When I completed my post-graduation, this mechanism was not mentioned. Now it is coming up, even studies have done this, even in macular degeneration and in this lens. There is an antioxidant mechanism of lens. So oxidants are the damaging chemicals, you can say, and antioxidant mechanism will try to save the damage from the oxidants. So oxidants are like superoxide anion or nascent oxygen, lipid peroxide, lipid hydroxy peroxide, and out of these super peroxide radicals may be the most toxic to the lens. So body tries to have antioxidant mechanism. In that, there is enzymatic and non-enzymatic. This non-enzymatic research is going on, and up till now research has proved vitamin C, vitamin A, and carotenoids. They good amount or concentration of them will be an antioxidant mechanism preventing loss of transparency in the lens. In enzymatic defense mechanism, it is reduced glutathione, which we have mentioned, then glutathione peroxidase and catalase. So So these are the two, enzymatic and non-enzymatic mechanisms which play part in the maintaining transparency of the eggs. So in short, these already formed and clear transparent lens fibers become opaque in acquired cataract, and that is called the age-related cataract or acquired cataract. So what is the pathogenesis? It involves oxidation of lens proteins rather than antioxidant mechanism, oxidation of lens proteins and lipids due to deficient preventive antioxidant mechanism. So this antioxidant mechanism, which is protective, it fails or deficient, and then oxidation supersedes it and produces the clear lens fibers into the opaque ones. Now this is another question which can come to you anywhere, even in your NEET examination PG, as MCQ, or it can come in your examination as a short question part of that. Definition, usually probably every staff faculty of our college wants from you definition, means word to word same. Description may be anything. If you want to say, just explain what do you know about cataract, you can tell anything related with cataract. But when anybody is asking ki define cataract, always every batchmate, every student should tell same thing, because it is a definition word to word same. So what is that definition? Usually for us, the Bible or basic book, every word and word has got deep meaning in it, is person. The person's definition of cataract, not persons, it is definition, but person, in person it is given nicely and in bold manner. Cataract is an opacity of lens or its capsule, either congenital or acquired. Very small, compactly defined sentence is there of the cataract. Remember this, very simple. And if you answer this, remember this, your knowledge will be appreciated by everybody. And you also understand the problem. So what is that? Cataract is an opacity of lens. The lens which is transparent has become opaque, is called opacity. But one word after that is, or its capsule. Means what? Ki cortex and nucleus is not opaque, but anterior capsule can be opaque. Only posterior capsule can be opaque. And this all thing can be from birth or because of some problem which occurs during pregnancy or within early periods of development, or maybe already fully developed, 10, 12, 15, 20 years, the lens is clear. And after 20, 25 years, that person gets trauma. And then there can be a cataract. Then old age can have cataract. Some radiation exposure can have cataract. That is quasi-acquired cataract. Clear lens fibers become open. Then another interesting questions we ask you, that is word meanings of each. Cataract, glaucoma, pterygium, staphyloma, and many things. So here cataract, what is word meaning of cataract? It is waterfall. These words were given, or some titles were given to the disease, because they, that time they were thinking in a different manner. They thought that is some problem in the circulation or formation and of that fluid inside the eye, mainly aqueous humor, is going in front of the lens and causing blurring of vision. So it is like this water or aqueous humor is falling in front of the lens and disturbing the vision. So they named it as a cataract. So that cataract word remains same, but etiology or that basic problem identified is a opacity of the lens and nothing like some water coming in front of the eye disturbing vision. Just like you cry and you have dimness of vision because of tears in front of the cornea. It is not like that. But problem, I can say ki if somebody is told ki you are suffering from cancer, you are probably high risk case of myocardial infarction, heart attack, then rather than getting that disease, mentally they are depressed. Because cancer, especially cancer, very high fear is there in the mind. Okay? Once cancer is labeled to patient, death is 100%. Not like that, but even for us, we have to be very cautious when declaring that patient sitting in front of us to say him ki you are a case of right eye cataract, both eye cataract, left eye cataract. So for this last sentence is important. Clinically, cataract refers to opacification of the and clinical definition. Sorry, there is phone. So actual definition is cataract opacity of the lens. So even if say 0.5 millimeter opacity in some corner of the lens is there, then as per your clinical judgment, you can say on slit lamp that this is cataract. So you label it on your documentation on OPD paper or IPD paper, but do not expose that small opacity to the patient as a cataract, because cataract, that patient will think this cataract means now in near future I have to get operated. So once that cataract is enough large to cause or impair vision, then you can declare, and there should be relation that size of cataract, position of cataract is responsible for impaired vision, then say you are having cataract and no problem. Once that opacity can be removed by surgery, opacity with lens, clear lens also, then you will get the vision. So it is curable. You are reduced vision or blindness is curable. So that is very important in clinical practice. This cataract is classified. Till now we have not seen many figures in this PPT, but you can go through it. The lens has got biconvex structure, transparent, anterior capsule, posterior capsule. Beneath the anterior capsule, you can say this is called as a subcapsular area. Beneath the posterior capsule, posterior subcapsular area. Then cortex, then nucleus. The parts of the nucleus we have seen: embryonic nucleus, fetal nucleus, infantile nucleus, and adult nucleus. Those things. So whenever you get a spot, white spot on the particular part of the these structures which I just mentioned, that you can say as a cataract, anterior capsular cataract, anterior subcapsular cataract, peripheral cortical, central cortical cataract, nuclear cataract, posterior subcapsular, posterior cortical, or posterior polar cataract, depending upon where that opacity is lying. But basically, two classifications are there. The one which I was telling was a morphological classification, and one which we usually use in clinical practice is etiological classification. Because etiological classification gives you next question arising from the patient and relative, if my cataract is removed, whether I will see or not. Okay. So for that classification is etiological, congenital and developmental and acquired. So first group is congenital and developmental, and second is acquired. Now, 2-3 points about congenital and developmental. Congenital and developmental, why it is written like that? The lens is developing. In that developing lens, some risk factor is playing at particular age. It may be within womb at 6 months, after birth 1 year, first birthday, like that. Some factor is playing, and the lens which is growing at that time gets affected by the cataract. So that in the developmental course of lens, problem occurs is called a developmental cataract. And something happened to mother, like I said, rubella. At birth only, the baby is born with cataract. That is called a congenital cataract. So that means, I want to say, if a baby is born not having any problem, lens is clear, but at the age of 1.5 year, 14 months, 16 months develops cataract, then it is just like a congenital cataract. Something went wrong in the early period only, but not at birth. So it is labeled as a developmental cataract. In acquired cataract, most common is a senile cataract, which occurs usually above the age of, say, 55 years. Two types are there, cortical and nuclear. Traumatic cataract, both it can occur after blunt trauma like fist injury, cricket ball injury, hockey stick injury, stone thrown, or it can be like a perforating, bullet or some arrowheads, sharp instruments, trauma, or even needle, horn. Complicated cataract, it is a cataract due to some other eye disease. It is not word like cataract is complicated. Complicated means there is a cataract end, but caused by the basic eye disease. The eye disease may be like uveitis, retinal detachment, high myopia, retinitis pigmentosa, those things. Then there can be metabolic cataract related with the diabetes, galactosemia, those things. Electric shock, electric current, that can also induce a cataract. Radiational cataract, you will understand that. Cancer patients are receiving radiation therapy and they protect important organs by the shields. So in that, some radiation is bound to go and that can be a source for a keratogenesis. Now this is important. Toxic, steroid induced, meiotic induced, copper and iron induced. Meiotic we will not touch more, but steroid induced. In ophthalmology in nutshell, there are two important drugs which we are using almost 80% in the daily prescription of the patients. One is antibiotics. Two antibiotics very commonly used are nowadays moxiprozacin and gatiprozacin. And another is steroid. Maybe prednisolone, dexamethasone, then medroxyprogesterone like those, or maybe fluromethalone, triamcinolone, those things. So these steroids are given for short time is okay, but in steroid responders, given for longer time, they induce glaucoma, they induce cataract, or they increase the risk of fungal infection. This is the topic of cataract, so they have included toxic steroid-induced cataract. That means if that person doesn't put their drop, he will not be the case of cataract. So responsibility lies on two. One is pharmacist and doctor. Unnecessary steroids should not be used. And when steroids are used, close follow-up should be done so that in course of due course of time, whether he is developing a small opacity in the lens or rise in intraocular pressure in form glaucoma, he is identified by the clinician and the steroids are withdrawn. Then that last, copper and iron induced. For earning purpose, we are working at many places, varieties of places as per your qualification. So in copper industry and iron industry, the workers which are there, they are constantly exposed to the high flying, velocity flying particles of copper or iron. And sometimes they can go inside the eye as an intraocular foreign body of copper. In copper industry and iron industry, intraocular foreign body of the iron. And it produces a cataract in the form of copper induced, it is called as a chalcosis, and iron induced is called as a siderosis. Dermatogenic cataract is cataract associated with some skin disease, atopic allergy like some osseous disease also can have cataract, and cataract may be associated with some syndromes, especially in babies, Down syndrome or Lewy's. Then morphological aspect, which I touched, capsular cataract, if it occurs on anterior side, anterior capsular, posterior capsular. Posterior capsular, initially I told, when that anterior part of the hyoid system doesn't close, then there can be a small dot on the posterior pole of the eye, that is called the mitten dot spot. Similarly, shallow anterior chamber at birth can touch iris with the cornea, and then if after delayed formation of anterior chamber occurs, anterior capsule can have a small spot. That is because of the delayed formation of the anterior chamber and touch of anterior capsule of the lens with the cornea. So this is the formation of the capsular cataract. Subcapsular cataract also can be anterior subcapsular or posterior subcapsular. Usually it is because of some problem or toxins coming from the aqueous humor or vitreous humor in the form of uveitis or vitreitis. Cortical cataract usually is age related or sometimes in a cases of that diabetes called as a snowflake cataract. Just above or below the nucleus, supra infranuclear cataracts are there. That is like a cap over the nucleus, supranuclear. Exactly within the nucleus, grown up adult nucleus is a nuclear cataract. Or there can be a polar cataracts, which are anterior polar and posterior polar, just like capsular cataract. So this anterior polar, there is small difference between capsule and polar. Capsule is like a, you can say, film, thin film of plastic. And if a cataract occurs within the film, it is capsular cataract. If it is projecting from capsule into the aqueous humor on the anterior capsule and posteriorly from the posterior capsule into the posterior chamber aqueous humor. So these are called as polar cataracts. And these polar cataracts, they look like a pyramid. So they are also called as a pyramidal cataract. pyramidal cut. This is again a figure from Khurana, which shows you how to remember. Very simple ways there. One side you start, go to the other side. Either you start from the anterior, go to the posterior, or start from posterior to anterior. Anterior to posterior is simple. So it is anterior capsular, anterior subcapsular, cortical, which can be peripheral, called as a coronary. Then towards the center, nuclear. On the intercapsule center, projected into the anterior chamber is pyramidal. Then zone of the lens, growing lens is involved. In again, first 9 months in pregnancy, during pregnancy, usually vitamin D deficiency is the cause. Is cause a lamellar or zonular cataract. So these are the zones which can get affected because of particular risk factor playing part at the time of that development of the lens. Now to end this today's lecture, these are some figures from Kansky tutorial. First figure or first slide is of a classification of congenital cataract, just which we named anterior polar. This one. Then posterior polar is slightly diffuse one, broader one, but it is present within the capsule. Sutural means there are two sutures. Y regular in the anterior capsule, subcapsular region, and in the posterior, inverted Y. So these sutures are transparent. Where the lens fibers meet anteriorly, it forms the Y transparent, and posteriorly inverted Y transparent. And when that Y becomes opaque, is called a sutural cataract. Then it can be coronary, lamellar, vitamin D deficiency is the cause, purulent, sutural, or focal dots. So mainly this lamellar, zonular cataract for you is important because it has got the etiology and it requires the treatment in the form of surgery in a child. This is subcapsular cataract, and it is giving you idea about how the eye or the lens looks under slit lamp. Here it looks like a gross torch magnified, but here you can see lens layers where it is in the anterior subcapsular area. Opacities are there. Nuclear cataract has got, usually cortical cataract has got white color, and nucleus cataract may be like a yellowish, dense white or yellowish or brownish or even blackish color, depending upon the pigment. So in the center, and yellowish looking, brown looking is a nuclear cataract, and peripherally white looking is a usually cataract which is called a cortical cataract. So this is cortical. So you can compare this nuclear cataract was yellowish to brown in color, and this cortical cataract is whitish in color and peripherally. So this patient have big opacities, but in the periphery. So patient through center may get okay vision, not 6x6 vision, but okay vision. Thank you.